NASA has big plans to send humans to Mars by the 2030s. And getting there isn't just a job for rocket scientists. Chemists are confronting some of the big challenges of getting a spacecraft to Mars and keeping its human passengers safe and healthy. It was the subject of a two-day symposium during the ACS national meeting in Washington, D.C. last month. That's where we caught up with Janet Cavandi, director of NASA's Glenn Research Center, to talk about the connection between chemistry and Mars exploration.
Chemistry has a huge part to play in almost every part of our lives, including a journey to Mars. We will need chemistry to help define how we grow plants, how we create our own medicines on the planet, how we will generate our own breathing air. There's all kinds of applications for chemistry in space.
That starts with getting to the planet. Sending stuff into space is expensive, and astronauts on a multi-year mission are going to need a lot of stuff. NASA researchers are investigating whether carbon nanotubes could be used to make lightweight composite structures to reduce mass and therefore the cost of escaping Earth's gravity.
If we want to go to Mars and not come back, if we do a one-way trip, it would be about $100,000 a pound. If we want to come back, it then scales to about $1 million a pound. So every pound we save is extremely significant.
Tests of early composites using carbon nanotube yarns show mechanical properties comparable to unidirectional carbon fiber, the current reigning champ of lightweight aerospace materials. And Siochi's team is working to further improve the nanotube composites.
For carbon nanotubes, right now we're basing the composite work that we're doing on resins that were originally developed really for carbon fiber, but carbon fiber and carbon nanotubes are not exactly the same, and so now we're stepping back and trying to figure out how we can tailor, we need to be thinking about how we tailor the chemistry of resins specifically to interact optimally with carbon nanotube surfaces.
With every pound at a premium, astronauts can't possibly bring everything they'll need on their journey to Mars.
Up there, you can't, if something breaks, you can't go buy another one, and you can't go to the grocery store if you need food, and you can't go to the pharmacy if you need medicine. So you'll have to learn how to make your own up there, and we're trying to learn how to use printing and in situ resource utilization to create a lot of the materials that we need while we're there on the planet.
Mark Blenner from Clemson University is one of the people tackling this challenge of in situ manufacturing on Mars. His work involves engineering microorganisms to produce polymers, nutrients, and other useful products as they're needed.
So in situ manufacturing really means making what you need in place. So if, for example, we're talking about going to Mars, it's being able to manufacture materials, nutrients, food, using the resources available on Mars.
And what's available is waste from astronauts, notably their nitrogen-rich urine and carbon dioxide in their breath. At the ACS meeting, Blenner outlined his vision for a biochemical space factory involving a yeast called Urea lipolytica that can take these feedstocks and convert them into useful products like polyesters. Blenner anticipates then 3D printing these polymers to make tools or other parts that astronauts may need. Blenner's team can also engineer the yeast to manufacture nutrients, such as omega-3 fatty acids, that could help keep astronauts healthy during their trip to Mars.
Omega-3s in particular are useful for astronauts because it's been implicated in prevention of bone loss, which is a serious problem that astronauts face.
Keeping astronauts safe and healthy during their flight to Mars requires not only good nutrition, but sensors to monitor their exposure to certain chemicals, along with radiation. Researchers like Tim Swager of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology are focused on the former, developing next-generation tools to sense potential chemical threats, along with the current stalwart of analytical chemistry, the mass spectrometer.
A problem with something like that, though, is it can get fouled, and it's complicated, expensive, and if you suck something into it that contaminates it, you're really stuck.
Swager says he's fusing chemistry and nanotechnology to make miniaturized chemical detectors with fewer vulnerabilities than more sophisticated instruments. His team is developing inexpensive sensors based on carbon nanotubes that can operate continuously on minimal resources.
One of our favorite platforms is carbon nanotubes. We can do different types of functionalization with them. That functionalization makes them interact specifically with the chemicals of interest. So we really need versatile sensors that can detect many different things, a changing environment, and be a trigger to know that something's going wrong.
While Swager predicts astronauts may still pull out the mass spec for precise chemical identification, he sees a benefit to having a simpler alternative that can always be on duty. But as promising as this all sounds, the researchers we spoke to stressed that putting humans on another planet is complicated, and a mission to Mars can't afford to rely on unproven technology. NASA's Office of Inspector General recently released a report emphasizing the technical hurdles of this mission. 2030 may feel like a long way off, but for the scientists making the materials and technology to get to Mars, it's just around the corner. Despite these challenges and deadlines, we left the meeting with a sense of optimism about this mission and those that follow it.
So I would say we are working on materials now to have things ready for the 2030 timeframe. Those things are in process now, have been for several years, and will continue to be a process that we endure for a long time.
This is just a sampling of the space chemistry we'll be keeping an eye on. What chemical space travel technology fascinates you? Let us know in the comments.